money on monitoring, but this is part of this theoretical session, so I presume this is a pure theoretical question. And in practice, yes, we should spend money.
Yeah, hopefully, it depends on the case. It is basically the fundamental question, I think, of our cost action. Yes, this presentation is the corresponding fact sheet are basically based on a paper that was published 3 years ago and on TAT-12 monitoring control and co-authored, apart from me, by Professor Brian Kuglicic and Sigda Adiansen from Princeton University that are here acknowledged. And the logic of this presentation and of the fact sheet is not to explain you anything. This is addressing a community different by us. So it's just a way to explain to a community which is not acquaint with the concept of decision, with the concept of Bayesian analysis, what is in practice the value of information. So if we talk about benefit of monitoring, so we all agree that monitoring should be seen as a powerful tool for taking decision, but in practice, when you go to a department of transportation, you talk with a decision to a bridge owner, and you propose them to install monitoring system. I think very often, I don't know if you have this experience in the past, they're very, very skeptical about that. They say, why am I supposed to spend my money on monitoring? And even they install the monitoring system, then they not necessarily take decision based on what the monitoring system is supposed to tell them. So one of the arguments against the installation of monitoring is, if I have some money, I spend this money on a reinforcement intervention, so it's very clear the benefit to my structure. So it will improve the capacity of my structure. But what does monitoring to my structure? Does it change the capacity? Well, I presume not. So does it change the demand load? Not even. So why am I supposed to spend money on monitoring? Yeah, of course, we all know that the solution, and we can find a solution on this problem, recasting the problem into the decision theory we have seen before. So the logic is to evaluate this value of information. We can explain in simple words to one individual that is not acquainted with this concept that the value of information is basically the money that he will save or her save every time interrogate the monitoring system, or in other words, is the maximum price that the owner is willing to pay for the information from the monitoring system. So the general formulation is always the same. The value information is the difference between the cost that I'm going to pay during the life cycle of my tractors if I don't use monitoring, minus the cost or the operational cost of my tractor if I use the monitoring. So this implies that basically the owner can undertake, can change the way, can change his decision based on information monitoring. It is an antitrust requirement of monitoring. So we wanted to demonstrate and to calculate the value information in a very simple, ideal case. This is not necessarily realistic, but it's very useful to set a very simple case study. So as a fact of a case study, we selected Tricker Bridge at Princeton campus. I don't know if you have some Princetonian, but you probably know very well this bridge. This is a pedestrian bridge that was designed by Christian Meng and funded by one of the alumni of Princeton University, John Erickson Tricker. And it basically is a very peculiar design. You see it has a is made with this very, very slender weather steel arch supporting a potential concrete deck. And this bridge overpass a road that basically cut into Princeton campus. The name of this road is Washington Road. And we're talking about decision, so if we want to set a case study, we have to define what is the tractor, but we are also to define who is the decision maker. We have to explain who is going to take the decision. And so for this case, we introduced a fictitious character. We called him Tom. He's the responsible of an imaginary design and construction office in Princeton University. There is actually a design and construction office in Princeton, but the manager is not named Tom, and he doesn't take decision in the same way that we will see here. But basically, this is the prototype of the rational agent that behaves in completely rational manner. He wants to minimize the operational cost of his tractor. For him, utility is linear with cost, and for him, there is no separation between the cost to the agency, the cost to Princeton, and the cost to the users. So he has a special concern about this bridge. So you see this bridge overpass this busy road, and he's concerned that a truck which is driving on this road may, by driving or maneuvering, may collide with the steel arch and then jeopardizing the safety of the bridge. And to this decision maker, there are, just to simplify the problem, let's say that there are two possible states of the bridge. So the bridge could be severely damaged. So in severely damaged means that there is a chance of collapse immediately after an accident, a road accident. And the bridge may have no damage. So there may be some cosmetic damage, but it doesn't jeopardize the reliability of the bridge. And say that Tom is sitting in his office, and at some point he receives a phone call and says, look, there is a truck that collided with the bridge. So what is he supposed to do? Say that he has only two options. He can do nothing and say, okay, there's no problem. I leave the bridge open to the pedestrian traffic and I leave the road open, or I can close the bridge. So close the bridge means closing not only the bridge, but also the underneath road, and so close all the traffic that goes through that. And he had to take a decision about that. So how is he going to think? So now Tom thinks, okay, what happened if I close the bridge? What are the consequences of closing the bridge? So if I close the bridge, okay, I have to pay a daily road user cost that I estimate in the order of $5,660 per day. So, and I estimate a downtime of 1 month, so with a total downtime cost of $139,800. Then you can say, what happened if I don't close the bridge? If I don't close the bridge and there is no damage, of course I pay nothing. But if I don't close the bridge and there is a severe damage, there is a chance of collapse. So if there is a collapse, I have to pay 2 months of road closure. I have to, there may be some fatality, and I have to pay also this fatality cost. There may be injury, I have to pay that. So the estimated cost for that is estimated by Tom in $881,000. Okay, so this is basically the table that summarizes the possible option of Tom and the possible outcome of his decision that depend on the state of the bridge. So if I close the bridge, I pay a flat rate, and this is $139,800. If I do nothing and there is no damage, I pay nothing. If I do nothing and there is a damage, I have to pay this amount. So translated in a decision tree, the decision tree is very simple. Here there is the decision node where I can choose to close the bridge and I pay the downtime cost, or I can choose to do nothing, and then there is a chance node, and the outcome depends on the state of the bridge, which Toms don't know. So the state could be damage, and so you have to pay the failure cost. The state could be undamaged, and so you have to pay nothing. And if we want to estimate the utility or the expected loss, we can use linear utility theory to estimate that in this simple case. And so the total cost would be the probability of having the damage times the cost of failure. So we have to introduce what is the prior probability to Tom of having a damage or not having a damage. And for this exercise, I say it is 30% of having a damage and 17% for not having the damage. So we'll get back to the decision tree. And let's calculate the expected utility in the two, the expected loss in the two cases. So on the first decision case, so we have a total downtown cost of $139,800. And in the second case, so we have to multiply 0.3 times 881, and we achieve $264,000. So what's going to be the decision by Tom? So in this case, the cheaper of the two is closing the bridge. So it will close the bridge based on this information. And the expected cost without monitoring will be the same downtown cost, $139,800. Okay, what happens if the bridge has some monitoring system installed? How does the decision by Tom change? This bridge actually has a monitoring system and was chosen as a case study exactly for that. This system is very complicated, actually. There are a number of fiber optic sensor systems based on FPG, based on OTDR. Okay, but again, we want to make a very simple example and a very academic example to explain in simple words how decision-making work in this case. So let's say that Tom disregards all the information from the monitoring system and set that coming from a single sensor, which is the sensor located at mid-span of the bridge deck. This is basically a strain gauge that tells him what is the elongation immediately after the bridge accident. Okay, how does his decision change based on information from the monitoring system? So the decision tree will be exactly the same. What changes is that we are not using anymore his prior information, but we are using the posterior information, the information after receiving the information from the probability after receiving the information from the monitoring system. So we must calculate the way how Tom will calculate the posterior information. So we have to calculate the likelihood. So what is the expected observation from the monitoring system, from the strain gauge, that is expecting to get if there is no damage? Okay, if there is no damage, it's expecting to see no change in the strain recorded at the bridge, but okay, there is always some noise in the monitoring system. This depends on the thermal effects and many other causes, and say that to him, the normal response of the bridge is described by the information. So this elongation epsilon is what is reading on the sensor. And you say, okay, if there is no damage, I'm expecting to hit zero, but maybe not exactly zero. So let's say zero plus minus 300 microstrain, something like that. What I'm expecting to see if there is a damage? I'm probably expecting to see something like this. Okay, if the damage is very big, such big that collapse the bridge, there is no need to see anything from the monitoring system. But if the bridge is still standing, we probably have a significant change in strain, say in the order of 1 per 1,000, something like this. And there is a big uncertainty in this number, of course, and say that the scattered and standard deviation is in the order of 600 microstrain. So this is what he's expecting to see. If there is no damage, this is what he's expecting to see if there is a damage on the bridge. So what is the posterior probability of having the damage? Okay, we can use directly the Bayesian rule. Okay, say that I read 400 microstrain at my sensor. Okay, so if I have a damage, this is the likelihood for damage. If I don't have any damage, this is the likelihood. So this is I can calculate therefore the joint probability of having the reading this number and having the damage, and the joint probability of reading the number and not having the damage. And the posterior probability is simply of having the damage is simply the joint probability of having the damage and reading this number, so with the red bar, divided by the sum of the red and the green bar. So it's basically our evidence. Okay. Okay, the point is, okay, perfect. So if we have an individual observation, we can calculate the posterior probability of having the damage. But we need to observe something before doing that. But here we are in a prior situation. We didn't have any accident. We didn't make any observation, actually. And we have to evaluate whether our monitoring system is useful or not. So we have to calculate the same value in terms of to a pre-posterior analysis. So we have to, the expected loss that we calculate here, for example, depend on the observation that we are going to have. Okay, so it will change based on the observation. So what gonna be the expected loss cumulatively? Okay, so here we see what is the cost for any action undertaken by Tom immediately after after the observation. Of course, if you close the bridge, it will always pay the same. It will always pay $139,800. But if you do nothing, his expected loss depend on what he observe. And for example, if he observes something very close to zero or lower than zero, so he will probably pay very few, but if he observes something in the order of 600, 700, 1,000, so it's very likely that there is a damage. So he will have to pay a big penalty in this case. So the cost, the expected cost is basically the minimum of these two actions. So the better action is the one that entails the lower cost. So is this one. So up to this point, for example, it is convenient to do nothing. Above this value, it is economically convenient to close the bridge. Observe that the threshold that separates the field, it is more convenient doing nothing, it is more convenient to close the bridge. So this value, it is different from the threshold that separates the field. It is more likely there is no damage, it is more likely there is a damage. So there is a field, for example, where it is more likely that there is a damage, but it is still more convenient to close the bridge. Because we are talking about something, an economic decision, we're not talking about what is more likely the state of the bridge. Okay, perfect. So we have to evaluate the pre-posterior value of the of our system. To do that, so we simply cumulate all the possible outcomes, multiply all the possible probability of occurrence. So it is basically the integral of the expected cost, posterior cost, times the probability of having an outcome. So, and we go back to the same formulation that we have seen before. And we calculate that in the case of Tom, so we calculate a cost of $84,600. So summary, so the value information is basically the Tom is willing to pay for the information that is coming from that individual monitoring system. So if there is no monitoring system, the operational cost to Tom is $139,800. If he's relying on the monitoring system, the operational cost C star is given by this integral. And if we calculate this, we obtain $84,600. So the difference of the two is our value information. So in this case, is $55,200. Okay? So in this case, if the monitoring system is less expensive than the value, it makes sense to install a monitoring system. If the monitoring system is more expensive, it doesn't make any sense to install any monitoring system. What is the nature of the value information? Let's look at the quantity that are involved. I'm almost done. It's so relaxed. Okay, these are, so there are some quantity that represent the financial impact of the action. So the cost of failure, the cost of downtime are those highlighted here in blue, okay? So there are other questions, so have nothing to do with the monitoring system per se or with the tractual behavior per se. There are some quantity related to the knowledge of the state of the tractor that again have nothing to do with the monitoring system, are just based on the engineering knowledge of the owner about the state of the bridge, or the prior information. So you see that, for example, C depend only on those quantities. It has nothing to do with the monitoring system per se. Okay. So where the quality of the monitoring system enter? This enter only in this quantity here. Is the sensitivity of your monitoring system to damage. Okay. So, in conclusion, to appreciate the benefit of monitoring, so we must account for the impact of the decision, and we want to quantify it. We are using this quantity that we call a value of information, which is basically the maximum part of the owner is willing to pay for the information from the monitoring system. The existence of the quantities imply that the manager can undertake some action in reaction of the observation from the monitoring system. If you can't do nothing, the value of the monitoring system is zero. And we have observed that they depend on a lot of quantities that are not necessarily related to the monitoring system per se. So these are basically the impact, the financial impact of an action or the general impact of an action, and the probability of a scenario and the sensitivity of monitoring system to damage. And most of the quantities depend on the owner and doesn't depend on your system. So thank you for your attention, and I want to acknowledge Branko Glišić, Sigrid Adriansen from Princeton University, all the people from Turner Company that are involved in the construction of the bridge, and a number of people from Princeton University that cooperated in the actual monitoring of the bridge, Matteo Pozzi, Carnegie Mellon University, and finally, Ivan Bartoli, that gave his face to play the role of Tom into this presentation. So thank you for your attention.
Okay, we have actually very short time for discussion and questions. So I would like to invite Daniel, Chris, and Henning back to the stage, and you can ask the presenters questions about their presentations, or you can make some comments about what we are doing in Working Group 1. And we have really very short time for that. Yes, Miroslav.